So let's begin the lecture. This is lecture number 7, and in this lecture we will cover process states. We will talk different states of process and then types of schedulers. So first we will discuss how many process states are available. We have already talked about that any program at the time of execution become process. And we have already discussed what is the difference between process and program. Right? So at the time of execution of a program is called a process. And whenever process comes into the primary memory, it can have certain number of states. A process can belongs in number of states. So we have different 5 states in which any one process can be belongs to anyone. So if we categorize the name of states, the first state is new state. Second state of the process is ready state. Third state is running. Fourth is waiting, and fifth is terminated. So these are 5 different states in which a process can be belongs. Now, what is the function of new state? What is the function of ready state, running state, waiting state, or terminated state? We will discuss one by one. First, new state. This state indicates that a new process are being creating by user. Now, what does it mean by if a user creating a process, creating a program, after execution of that program, that process become program become process. Like I am writing something here. Suppose I'm designing a C programming code, and then when I'm designing that particular code, that means my program is belonging to new state. Now, sometimes operating system can also create some process by using the fork system call. Fork system call creates new process. So there are 2 ways to create or design the new process. First, the user can create process, and operating system also having some system calls to create a new process. So whenever we execute our program, whenever we run any command by using command interpreter, operating system creates some process for us related to that program. So very first state of a process is called new state. And what we have to write in this state indicates that a new processes are being creating by user. And the question arises in mind, how user can create a new process? So user can use the system call, and the name of system call is fork, F-O-R-K. This is the system call can be used by user as well as operating system. And the purpose of fork system call is by which we can create a new process. Once a new process has been created in the primary memory, it belonging to ready state. Now in the diagram, as you can understand, if a process is being creating, it belonging to new state. Once all the input output performed in the new state, a new process, that process admitted from the new state to ready state. Now, ready state having a data structure in which it can store the newly process coming from the new state. So every state, whether we are talking about the ready state, running state, waiting state, all the states having some data structure like stack or queue, which works for picking up the process from the queue and admit it to the ready state. Once the ready state completed its work, it scheduler works. There are scheduler works called dispatcher. Dispatcher will select the process from the ready queue and admit it into the running queue or running states. So right now we are talking about the ready queue. That means a new process which are already created, a process already have completed their input output operations, designing operations, right? So we can admit this process from new state to ready state. Ready state having a data structure called queue in which process start storing our context. So let's discuss a ready state. This state indicates process is ready to be assigned to a processor for execution. I told you in the last lecture that running state is the state where CPU is allotted to the process for being executed. Ready queue, that means a process is going to be executed, but it is not currently executing. CPU is allocated in the running state. And for ready purpose, process can store in the ready state. So ready state indicates that process is ready to be assigned to a processor for execution. Now, which process is being selected from the ready queue? As I told you, ready queue having a data structure. It has some data structure like queue, and you know that queue work in the basis of first come first serve. So process enter in queue first, it's scheduled for execution first. So first come first serve, that means a process which comes first, CPU will allocate it to first. So ready state having a data structure called queue, which works on the basis of first come first serve. It means process whichever comes first in the queue will allocate CPU first in the running queue. So selection of the process is based on FCFS manner, and the selection process is done by a scheduler called short term scheduler or dispatcher. We will talk about later after this topic how many schedulers which works between the five different states. Currently we are talking about the ready state. So what we have already discussed, a ready state, it indicates a process is ready to be assigned to a processor for execution. It has some data structure called queue. queue works on FCFS manner, first come first serve. It means process whichever comes first in the queue will allocate CPU first in the running queue. Now, size of the ready queue is concerned by operating system. We cannot decide the size of the queue, how many processes which are currently being ready for execution. We cannot define the size of ready queue. So it is the matter of operating system. It can decide how much the size will be. So size of the ready queue is concerned, or it is the matter of operating system. So in this way, so many processes are being stored in the ready queue one by one. And then the next state is running state. Now somehow we have to select some process from the ready queue to running state. That means we are executing our program, that means we are running our process, we are transferring our process from ready state to running state. So running state will be the third most important state of the process. So let's talk about what it does for the process. So if we talk about the running process, running state, this state indicates instructions or process are being executed by CPU. So currently execution activities done by the running state. Process cannot be allocated to the processor. That means CPU cannot be allocated except the running state. Running state is the only one state where CPU allocates to a process and start their execution. Right? So this is the arrow from ready queue to running queue, which indicates processes are being transferred from ready queue to running queue, or ready state to running state. Now, the next arrow indicates interrupt. Interrupt generated from the running state to ready state. Now, what kind of interrupt can be generated during the execution of the process? So we know that there are so many interrupt. There are so many obstacles during the execution of the process. Suppose you are executing your C program and you miss to declare a variable, suppose integer a, and you are using that variable a in your function or somewhere else, but the variable a is not declared. So at the time of execution, operating system generate an interrupt that you are not declare such kind of variables and you are using that variable in a function. Or for example, we can take another example. You did not have a declare any function. You did not declare any prototype of the function, and you are using or you are calling that particular function. So in this way, at the time of execution, CPU experience that something has missing in this program, which terminate or which put into the suspend mode or waiting mode in the process. So in the running state, there must be possible that process can be terminated successfully, or it may generate interrupt, or by using interrupt handling technique, it can transfer from running state to waiting state or suspended state, we can say. A waiting state having so many names: waiting state, suspended state, awaited states. So these are some names of waiting state. So from the running state, it is possible or it might possible that process which are currently being executing in the running state can be transferred from running state to waiting state, because that process generated the interrupt because it required some input output operations right now. It required some resources. It having some syntax error. So these kind of errors can be occur by which interrupt can be generated, and after interrupt generated, process, the context of the process can be transferred from the running state to waiting state. And as well as the context of the process will be transferred from running state to waiting state, all the text portion, all the data portion, all the stack portion which are located in the primary memory, the entire context will be transferred from one location to other location. So somehow we have to sweep out all the context of the program, all the context of the process from running state to the waiting state. So this is the purpose of running states. These states indicates instructions or process are being executed by the CPU. So it is very simple definition that we are allocating a CPU to the process or an instruction for executing. We want to execute our program, we want to execute our process, we want to execute all the instructions in the process. So without CPU we cannot execute. So the allotment of the CPU to a process or instruction can be done in the running state. Now during the execution of the program, what might happen we have already discussed. So let's clear once again. During the execution of the program, it might happen that CPU required that it process which are being currently executing in the running state, it does not meet some input output operations properly, right? It does not have some input output properly, or we can say the prototype of the function does not meet in the proper way. Some resources does not meet in proper way. So it required some resources, but CPU could not able to get that resources. It required some functions declaration, but CPU cannot find that function declaration. Now, due to these reasons, processor cannot execute this process completely. It cannot terminate that process properly, because it does not finish our execution, because it makes some deficiencies regarding resource, input output operations or functions declaration, or it may be anything. So in due to this reason, the what processor decides, the process which are currently being executing in the running state, it has to transfer from different locations. So there are some input output event wait. Input output event wait means some interrupt, maskable or non maskable, can be generated, or some input output requirement may be generated. So due to any reason the process gets interrupted. So after interrupt signal which generated from the running state to the ready state, the all the context of the process will be transferred from running state to ready state, waiting state. Now after transferring all the context of the process from running to waiting state, dispatcher will select the next ready to execute process from the ready queue and put into the running queue. Now CPU allocate to the different process and start executing to other process. So this cycle will continue till the ready queue finished processes, and in this way the process transferred from one location to other, from one state to other states. So this is the meaning of input output or event wait. Now next state is terminated. Let's discuss first the waiting state, then we will discuss the terminated state. So as I told you that if process having any difficulties for execution, processor shift that process from running state to waiting state by calling some function, by calling or by generating some requirement. It may be some input output resources, it may be some event, it may be some function declaration, it may be some variable declaration, right? This is called event. Now for which purpose it gets comes into the waiting state, this event will be successfully completed. Now the resource availability and the event successful, the creation of event successfully or availability of resources successfully cannot be done in running state. So process transferred from running state to waiting state. Now in the waiting state, again, what we have to do? Whatever be the requirement of process by which it can get terminate, it can get suspended from running to waiting, we find out what is the problem in our process execution. Is there any problem related to the resource like memory requirement? Is there any problem related to the hardware resources? Like it might possible that our process required printer and printer is not connected in that time. Right, so we will check what is the actual problem by which our process gets in suspended states from the running state. So we diagnosis, we troubleshoot our problems in the waiting state, then we will complete all the event, all the input output requirement, whatever be the requirement of the process in the waiting state. So waiting state tells us what is the problem in our process, and we will fulfill that problem, and again we will transfer the process from waiting state to ready state. So this arrow from waiting state and it goes to the ready state, it shows that we have completed So arrow shows that we have completed our input output requirement. We have completed event that are required by the process. Now after completion of event, after completion the input output requirement of our process, we transfer that process from waiting state to ready state. So this arrow shows these things. Now again, in the ready state, we know that a process is being ready for execute, but the allocation of CPU will on running state. So again, from the ready state, there are dispatcher, there are scheduler called dispatcher or short term scheduler, which again select that process which are right now transferred from waiting state to ready state. It will select by the dispatcher program and transferred from ready to running, and that process again gets chance to allocate the CPU. So this is the purpose of waiting queue. So this state indicate a process that cannot execute until some input output event occurs, such as completion of an input output operations, assigning the higher priority to the process, non-maskable interrupt. So these are some example of event which might generated during the execution of the program. So after completion of this event, what we have to do, we have to simple transfer our program from waiting to ready state. Then again dispatcher will select our process from ready state and it will transfer from ready to running. CPU again start allocating to the process and it will start executing that particular process. So this is the purpose of waiting queue or waiting state. Now the last state is terminate. We know that what is the meaning of terminated. That means if process generate the output and process display the output on the output devices like monitor or projector, that means it have completed our execution. Now it is called in the terminated state. We can say exit state. So if a process completed their execution, it generate the output and output is transferred from the output devices, process gets terminated by itself. This is called the exit state. So this arrow shows that after generating the output to the output devices, it goes terminated itself. All the resources which are occupied by the process, it releases before the termination. So this is called terminated state. This state indicates a process has been finished execution from the process control block. So this is called terminated state. So we have discussed different five states: new state, ready state, running state, waiting state, and terminated state. If you want to create a new process, that means we are working on new state. Now, whenever we created completely our process, we have inputting everything, we have designed everything, it goes to the ready state. Ready state having a data structure called queue, where a new process can be stored properly. Now we know that the data structure queue work on first come first serve manner. So from the running states, a dispatcher program select the process in FCFS manner from the ready queue, and it will transfer process from ready to running. Now during the running process during the execution of the process in running state, it might happen there are two possibilities: either our program executed properly, executed successfully, and it goes to terminated, or it might generate some interrupt, it might feel some experience some problems during the execution of the process. It required some input output resources, it required some input output operations, it required some memory resources. It maybe user generate maskable interrupt or non-maskable interrupt. So this kind of interrupt, this kind of event may be generated in running state. Now due to this reason, to handle the interrupt, it transferred the context of the process from running to waiting state, and it select the next process from the ready state. Now after reaching the process in waiting state, it complete our resource requirement, it complete our event, and then again it will reschedule in the ready queue. Then again dispatcher is a program which select ready that process from the ready queue and put into the running queue. And again that process gets chance to execute, and then it terminate itself, it releases all the resources which are occupied by the process, and then the whole cycle can be continuously running on in the primary memory. So this is how the single process, the life cycle of a single process. In the same way, we can have 1,000 process in the primary memory, each process having 5 different process states. So this is the lifestyle, this is the life cycle of process, we can say. So new, ready state, running state, terminated state, waiting state, and then finish. Now we have a limited time, so we will discuss only the scheduler name. How many types of scheduler works between 5 different state? we will discuss in detail in the next lecture how the long term scheduler works and how the short term scheduler works and how the medium term scheduler works. So for today's, we just know there are three kind of scheduler, and scheduler is nothing. If we define the scheduler, then we can simply write scheduler is a program which schedule the process from one state to other states. Now, as you can see in the diagram, from the new state, we have to select some process which are being currently designed properly or successfully. There must be some program which select process from new state to ready state, right? Now suppose process enter into the ready state, and for selecting process from the ready state to running state, again in between two different states, we required some program. In the same way, from running state to waiting state, from waiting state to ready state, there must be a program exist which select or which transfer from running to waiting and waiting to ready. Right? In order to perform this kind of selections of the process, we required three different schedulers. So scheduler is a program which select process from one state to other state. So we have three different scheduler. First is long term scheduler, which works between new state to ready state long term. It required so many time because a process can take so many time for creating. That is why a long term scheduler works between two states called new state and ready state. Now the second is short term scheduler. Short term means it can select a process in very short period of time, because in the ready state there are so many processes which are ready to execute. So short term scheduler works between two states, ready state and running state. So this is a short term scheduler. The second type of scheduler is short term scheduler, or another name is dispatcher. Dispatcher and short term scheduler both are hand to hand. So what is the purpose of dispatcher and what is the purpose of short term scheduler? It is a program which is used to select process from ready state to running state. Now medium term scheduler, that means due to interrupt, due to some event execution, it transfer our context from running state to waiting state. We have already discussed. Now there are so many processes which are in suspended mode, so there must be a program or scheduler exists between waiting state and ready state. So for transferring the process which are from suspended or waiting mode, it can transfer to the ready state. So in order to perform this transfer task, we required a scheduler called medium term scheduler. So medium term scheduler is a program which works between two states called waiting state to ready state. It can transfer the process from waiting state to ready state. So therefore we required three different scheduler: long term scheduler, short term scheduler and medium term scheduler. Long term scheduler can works between new state and ready state. Short term scheduler can work between ready state to running state, and medium term scheduler can works between waiting to ready state. So long term scheduler works between new state to ready state. Short term scheduler works between ready state to running state, and the medium term scheduler works between waiting state to the ready state. And short term scheduler is also known as dispatcher. और सीपीयू शेड्यूलर। सो यू जस्ट रिमाइंड द थ्री नेम्स। क्वेश्चन में भी आस्क्ड बाय यूजिंग अ सिंगल नेम, लाइक डिफाइन द सीपीयू शेड्यूलर, डिफाइन द डिस्पेचर प्रोग्राम, डिफाइन द शॉर्ट टर्म शेड्यूलर। सो डोंट बी कन्फ्यूज्ड, यू हैव टू राइट। इट वर्क्स बिटवीन टू डिफरेंट स्टेट, रेडी स्टेट एंड रनिंग स्टेट। So this is all about the today's lecture contents, in which we have discussed the process states new, ready, running, waiting and terminated, and we have already discussed some types of CPU scheduler.